So, hello everybody. My name is Sergio Arroyo, and I come from Tecnológico de Monterrey in Mexico. And I will be talking about the use of machine learning with thermoelectric materials based on polyaniline and zero-D carbon allotropes. So we first start with a general statement. And I can start saying that throughout the 20th century, there was a continuous growth in energy expenditure, along with advances in the number of people who had access to a higher standard of living, which finally led to a situation by like the current one, characterized by the concern caused by problems such as depletion of fossil fuels or greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide produced by the combustion of fossil fuels. The COVID-19 epidemic had significant effects on the energy demand in 2020, which resulted in a 5.1% decrease in the world in production of CO2 emissions. Since then, however, the world's economy has recovered incredibly, and unfortunate to us, in 2021, we almost recovered all the production of CO2 that we had been produced since 2019. As seen in the fi in this figure right here, the new human activities and increasing people had led to a rise of CO2 production after COVID-19 pandemics. This also means that oil demand had a big impact of generation of electricity. Today, due to global warming associated with fossil fuels and the constant growth in the cost of energy, it is necessary to search for a new, cleaner, and more sustainable energy sources. In our technological advanced world, green technologies like solar, photovoltaic, wind turbines, hydrothermal, and biomass have begun to play a significant part in that rise. As we can see in the diagram, the world has invested more in new clean energies rather than fossil fuels. This is because the CO2 emissions have made a warning in all countries. However, there's a big problem that the increasing demand of energy has not stopped yet. This makes us wonder the essential cause of all related issues of global energy, which have been seizing our attentions intensively. The technology used to implement renewable energy power supply is determined by the types of green resources that are readily available due to geographical advantage. That's why we need to start looking for other types rather than these green technologies. For example, all the waste energy that has not been used can be used for power generation. This is where thermoelectricity comes to the table. So the thermoelectric effect is a direct conversion of the heat to electricity and vice versa. Heat and electricity are interconverted in almost all processes, machines, and devices. Due to this and many other phenomena, many important studies are being carried out on electronic materials with the purpose of being able to implement them in the electronic industry and in possible applications for electric generators. The electronic properties of materials have been a subject of great interest from past centuries to the present. This transformation is a consequence of the Seebeck, Pilter, and Thomson effects. For this project, we will be focusing on the Seebeck coefficient effect, and it behaves from this equation, that is ZT equals sigma times S squared over K times T. What this means? Sigma, it's the electrical conductivity of the material that we are going to analyze. S is the Seebeck coefficient, T is the temperature, K is the thermal conductivity, and ZT is the efficiency that it's measured in thermoelectric materials, that it's also called figure of merit. there are many materials that we can analyze for thermoelectric applications. However, they all can have some advantages and disadvantages. First, we will start with metals. Maybe we can say that metals have great potential in thermoelectric applications. However, as we know, metals are great thermal conductors. So as mathematically speaking, from this equation, if they have great thermal conductivity, they will be less efficient for thermoelectric applications. So metals cannot be thermoelectric materials. There are also some semiconductors and specific materials called scutterites, Hausler materials, and clathrates. This has been proved in many articles and reports that they can be excellent thermoelectric candidates for thermoelectric applications. However, if we move to an economic situation, these materials are not viable for any industry, and they cannot produce in great scale these materials, so they cannot be used. That's why many researchers have been stopped using these materials and have been going to some others. For example, oxides and silicides. These are great candidates because they are cheap and they have considerable good efficiency for thermoelectric applications. However, researchers have been used these oxides and silicides with some other thermoelectric materials that also have great efficiency. However, they are toxic to the environment and to humans. So they cannot be produced in great scale also. So that's why in this project, we focused on organic materials. Maybe these organic have still low SET efficiency. However, they can be processed to compete with oxides and silicates and all the other materials I have mentioned before. Specifically speaking, we will be talking about conducting polymers. These conductive polymers have a great advantage against all the other materials because they have the opportunity of being doped and redoped. PANI, polyaniline, it's PANI, has the great advantage that, chemically speaking, has many functional groups that can attract other compounds and ions and can change its properties. They can have pi-pi interactions with many inorganic materials. When that said, it can increase electrical conductivity and reduce thermal conductivity, giving a better efficiency for thermoelectric applications. Other advantages of PANI for thermoelectric applications are that they are low cost, they have lightweight, they are low or even non-toxic to the environment. Its material abundance, since it's a polymer, it can be reproduced very easily. Chemically tunable, as I said, it can be doped also, and it has low thermal conductivity with the opportunity of increasing electrical conductivity. So, as I said, PANI is one of the most studied conductive polymers for thermoelectric applications, since it has great opportunity of be redope. How can we do this? We can dope the polymer matrix with some organic acids, such as chlorine acid and sulfuric acid. We can also use some nanofillers, for example, carbon allotropes that we will focus on this project, such as graphene, graphene quantum dots, graphene oxide, and reduced graphene oxide. And finally, we can do a functionalization of that carbon nanostructures for better improvement. These carbon allotropes can act as stabilizers, increasing the stability of carbon allotrope thermoelectric hybrids. This is due to the pi-pi interaction that can increase the thermal electrical conductivity. Also, it can increase a little bit Seebeck coefficient and keep the thermal conductivity as low as possible. Yes. However, there's a big problem that, well, it's not a big problem, but it's kind of a problem that consuming this in the laboratory, doing a lot of experiments to achieve a great set T is consuming resources, time, and money. So on the contrary, computational materials design aided by intelligent data analytics techniques allows for faster processing by requiring fewer experiments to achieve the desired result. Just as putting in context, SET-T normally is close to one in all reports, doesn't matter the material we are using. However, if we want to compete, if these materials want to compete for power generation in the industry, they need to have at least two. And if we want to use it as coolers, they need to be at least three. And for organic polymers, the maximum that has been achieved is 0.42. So it's not even close to compete with power generation materials that exist nowadays. So what are we using? We will be using machine learning so we can find all correlations between all parameters in the laboratory we can modify with these all output parameters like thermal conductivity, electrical, Seebeck, and figure of merit SET-T. We were using the correlation matrix, multiple linear regression, principal component analysis, and finally, artificial neural network. Artificial neural networks are mathematical representations of linked processing units termed artificial neurons that are inspired by the idea of information processing in biological systems. Each connection between neurons' intensity may be increased or decreased by a weight that is modified during the learning process. Signals are only processed by following neurons if a particular threshold specified by an activation function is surpassed. Neurons are often arranged into networks with several levels. Because of its learning power, simple adaptability to varied situations, ability to form generalizations, and lack of demand to specify the link between input and the output, artificial neural networks is chosen in the solution of complicated issues. Also, it has the capacity to identify the link between input and outputs based on the system factors. Thus, artificial neural networks may create acceptable outputs to the inputs of a specified system with uncertain output values, making it easier to solve difficult issues. There are many techniques that exist for artificial neural networks. However, in this project, we use backpropagation system. This system is a technique used in supervised learning algorithms to train ANNs using the gradient descent method. It works by partially deriving the cost or error function from any weight in network to determine how rapidly the cost changes when weights are altered, as well as providing details on how these changes modify the network's behavior. So for this project, first we needed to establish some input variables that can be modified or normally are analyzed in the laboratory. For example, the structure of PANI, because it can be one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or a mixture, or even there's no PANI. The doping reactants for this polymer, the type of carbon nanostructure that has been used, the functionalization, and all the quantitative variables that can be derived from this, including weight percentage and temperature. Also, we need to add the output variables that are the last four of table two, that are the civic, electrical, thermal, and figure of merit. Also, we can establish the minimum and maximum values of these, and then we can start analyzing with correlation matrix. These correlation matrices give us the idea of a direct correlation between the input and the output parameter, ignoring all other variables. So as we can see, there are some variables that will have more correlation with the output parameter and some ones with less. These correlation matrices results will vary between -1 to 1. Results closer to -1 mean that they have an inverse correlation between the input and output parameter, while closer to 1 is more direct correlated. However, these values cannot be closer to 0, because if it is close to 0, it means it's not significant for this analysis. So we need to establish some range that typically goes from -0.1 to 0.1. So in these tables, as you can see, all the green values mean that they are closer to 1, meaning they have a direct correlation. The yellow ones are non-significant, and red ones are inversely correlated to the output parameters. Multiple linear regression can provide us the typical plot of how linear and how does this analysis fit the data with the output parameters. But as we can see, in all results for all output parameters, it doesn't have a good linear correlation, meaning that it's not normally distributed. Typically, we want to find an R-square higher than 90%. And as we can see, it doesn't have any results. Additionally, multiple linear regression provide us some equations that fit this behavior. And it's provided here. Instead of giving you the equation, I made some tables so you can see the coefficients. Also, like correlation matrices, a negative coefficient gives an inverse correlation with the output parameter, and a positive one, a direct correlation. However, if we want to see if these parameters are significant or not in multiple linear regression, we need to focus on the p-value. This p-value provides us how significant it's for the equation. Typically, it needs to be lower than 0.05 to be significant. If it's higher, it's not significant. For example, in S, we can see the temperature has a p-value of 0.729, meaning it's not significant according to this analysis. So since we don't have a normally distribution in this analysis, we will be using polynomial regression. This polynomial regression can analyze two input parameters with the output parameter, and providing more efficient or maybe even a better distribution of this data. Since it's there are a lot of combinations, because we have 10 input variables, we need to reduce these variables to analyze. So we will be using only the variables that can be modified in the laboratory. For example, we can use a 1D PANI instead of 2D. So the structure will be considered. Also, the doping reactants that we will be using, functionalization, the type of nanostructure, the weight percentage, and temperature. A temperature is also considered here, because it's a central importance in any operative situation. As we can see also, we have some p-values. However, we can see that there are a lot that has great surpassed 0.05 the value. We have also the principal component analysis. This analysis creates new variables from the combination of different input parameters, and will give us some graph like this. And the closer is some variables to the output parameters means that it's better significant. If it's perpendicular to the output parameters means that it's non-significant. And finally, we have artificial neural network. These networks will provide us some hidden data that we cannot see easily, and will fit it in a better way. Normally, they give us some hidden nodes that we need to search for. And for these results, for electrical conductivity, it was 7 hidden nodes, for Seebeck coefficient 19, for thermal conductivity 16, and set T14. And as we can see, these data fitted better for some regression, having values between 0.95 and 0.99 in R squared, given that these results have better distribution than all other techniques. Now, continuing, we need to do some sensitivity analysis to see how these input parameters behave with our output thermoelectric parameters. Positive results will give us a direct correlation with the output parameter, while negatives will give us some inverse correlation. Here we won't have non-significant correlations due to the normal distribution, so we can continue with that. From this, we can make some surface plots to analyze and see better how these combinations will result in increasing or decreasing the thermoelectric parameters. For example, these graphs will have the combinations of weight percentage and functionalization versus Seebeck coefficient and weight percentage with the doping reactants. As we can see, if we accomplish a closed weight percentage of 90% of carbon nanostructures, doesn't matter if it's graphene, graphene oxide, or quantum dots, and a value of 1 on functionalization, we will have up to 200 in Seebeck coefficient. If I just return, we can see that the Seebeck coefficient that has been reported has a maximum value of only 79.24. We have done 3 times this Seebeck coefficient in our analysis. So if we go to the laboratory and we do these experiments, also there are other parameters that can affect this, but we can clearly see that it can be increased up to 3 times. Electrical conductivity, we can see that it's up to 2,000 Siemens per meter. And it also has increased from previous reports. Thermal conductivity, it's a little bit tricky because we need to focus on the low points. Since mathematically speaking, we need to decrease thermal conductivity to have better set T. So as seen in the table, as I can send you later, we have a minimum value in all reports from thermoelectric applications in PANI with carbon nanostructures of 0.1. This means that we can keep the 0.1 with a room temperature and a mixed type structure of PANI. This is a good result because typically all these parameters are intercorrelated. So this means if I increase electrical conductivity, thermal conductivity also will increase, giving us a bad result in set T. So if we can increase electrical conductivity, and as seen in this graph, we can decrease thermal conductivity, we will have better efficiency. Finally, we can see the graphs for set T. SETI, as I told you before, we need a value of approximately 2 to compete with power generators that exist nowadays. And as we can see, we can accomplish for almost 2.6. However, we need to focus that this 2.6 is on high temperatures of approximately 600 Kelvin. So we need to focus on the ones that are at room temperature, giving us some value of almost 2.1. So it can compete. And as we can see in the table before, the maximum that has been reported for PANI is only of 0.4, giving us 5 times this value. Finally, here is a summary of all machine learning techniques that we can see. For example, temperature plays a positive correlation with all input parameters except for electrical conductivity in artificial neural network. This is because it finds some hidden nodes that we cannot analyze and with some ease. However, this technique provides us this opportunity to see it, that it affects negatively. So some general key points that we have mentioned: thermoelectric materials have great importance for green energy harvesting. More and more researchers are exploring the inclusions of carbon nanostructures in conductive polymers to enhance SETI. Data-driven models could be used successfully to understand the role of the compositional and structural variables of CBEC, electrical conductivity, thermal conductivity, and figuring of merit. It was possible to recognize the parameters that have a positive and a negative influence on each of the variables to be analyzed. Artificial neural network allowed finding nonlinear connections between the input parameters to find the maximum possible values to be obtained for each response. And finally, the results explain that it is possible to obtain a SETI of almost 2.25 by turning the structural features on weight percentage of PANI in quasi-zero deep. Also, these techniques can also be applied in other laboratory areas, so we can find and optimize the results without wasting resources, time, and money. So I just want to give thanks also to my team, that is Dariush Embrahimbaga, Shubhra Bhattadatta, and my coordinator, Dr. Malar Ray, that comes from Tecnológico de Monterrey. Thank you very much. Here is my contact if you want any more information, you want to read the published article, and also here's my phone if you want to establish some conversation. Thank you very much.